just realized this morning, first service, I'm introducing a whole new generation to Get Smart, that classic television show, you know. Somebody came out first service and said, I keep waiting, since you're talking about the mouth, I keep waiting for you to pull your shoe off and use that shoe phone thing, you know. You guys remember that? See these kids up here, they don't get it, they don't understand. Dave doesn't, he's never seen Get Smart. Take your Bibles and turn with me to the book of Proverbs one more time. Proverbs chapter 18. We're going to go back into our series on Proverbs. We've been thinking about getting smart. Solomon writes and speaks for the Lord, encouraging God's people to become smart. And one of the areas, in fact, one of the most important areas, is learning to master our mouths. Some of you are kind of rolling your eyes and going, oh me, where are we going here? What you say and what I say is important. Words are important. Words are containers of power that we release into the world. Worlds are transformative. I remember growing up back in Tennessee and you know, reading books, and they would start with those words, once upon a time. And some of you know what I'm talking about when I say there seemed to be magic in those words. You read that once upon a time story, and the next thing I know, as a 5, 6, 7-year-old little boy, I was transformed. It changed me, and suddenly I was a knight in shining armor with my sword out, slaying dragons. Or, you know, I would read once upon a time, and all of a sudden I was more powerful than a locomotive, able to leap tall buildings in a single bound. You know, I had a tea towel around my neck, and I was Superman. That's how powerful those words were. And, you know, as I continued to grow up, we started realizing as children, as teenagers, just how much words did mean. We came up with that phrase, they taught us, sticks and stones can break your bones, but words never hurt you. Let me tell you something, that's a lie. There's nothing in the world true about that saying. Words are painful, words can hurt. Words can capture the attention. Words can inspire creativity and imagination. Words are serious business. Words can pick people up or words can put people down. Words can be used here and there and everywhere. And when you and I release our words, we release power. And we impact lives. Not only the life of the speaker is impacted by words, but the life of the hearer is touched by words. This morning, I have the opportunity to either waste 500 man hours through my words or to do something to encourage 500 people. All about words. Repeat this after me. My words.
My
words. My words.
My words.
Are important.
My words.
The words that come out of your mouth, the words that come out of my mouth. It's not just about the guy that stands up here that preaches on Sunday morning or the person that teaches. It's the words that you use every single day. Those words are important. Those words make a difference. This morning we're going to begin a two-part series looking at Proverbs and what Solomon says about words. It's so important that in all the Proverbs, Solomon deals with the issue of the tongue and the mouth and words more than any other. There are over 90 Proverbs that are at least implicitly, if not explicitly, directed toward our use of words. Must be an important thing. Listen, if God says something once, I need to pay attention to it. If He talks about something 90 times, maybe it's time to get smart about my words, about the things that I say. See, we are now in a creative world, and we create all new ways to speak, like Facebook. Things that we write about people, those words we're releasing have power. My words and your words are important. It's time to get smart about our words. Repeat it again. My words,
my words
are important. Proverbs chapter 18, verse 21. Listen to what it says. Have you found it? Hold your Bibles up. And I hope you've got your outlines out. Listen to what it says about words. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. And those who love it will eat its fruit. death and life. Sounds pretty serious to me. The power of death and life is right here. It's in my mouth. It's in your mouth. It's in the things that we say. We sometimes flippantly forget that the words that come out of our mouth, even the words that we say in passing, those words release power. My words are important. This week we're going to talk about the importance of words, the importance of our mouth. Next week we're going to get really, really practical and talk about training the tongue so that we say the right thing when we ought to say it and so that we leave the wrong thing unsaid when it shouldn't be spoken. I preached this sermon first service today, had people coming up after the service. One couple came up and said, "Got to be back next week to hear what it's about." It's not just about what we say, sometimes it's about how we say it. Words are important. Repeat it one more time. My words are important. Think with me about the importance. My words matter. Roman number one in your outline. Number one, first thing we discover is my words. Now I'm not going to cover all the things that Solomon says about words. I'm going to give you five or six things that I think are important. The first thing we discover is my words are shapers of destiny. My words and your words, it shapes the destiny of those people around us. Listen to what it says again. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. The things that you and I say, they have an impact on the people around us, and they shape the life that they develop, the life that they grow into. My words and your words shape the destiny of our own life and the destiny of others. You take a child and you raise that child, that all that child hears is that you're no good and you're a loser. Let me tell you, that can become a self-fulfilling prophecy. Those words shape destiny. Napoleon Hill said, "We need to be very careful with the words that we use and the influence that we have, because we are always planting seeds, either seeds of success or seeds of failure, into the life of those people that hear us." Every flippant word that we use that puts down someone else, that makes us feel big because we make someone else look small, those kinds of words shape destinies. Those kinds of discussions shape lives. See, the Bible says in Romans 10:17, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word. It's what we hear that shapes our faith. It's what we hear that shapes what we believe. It's what we hear that shapes who we become. It is important for us to hear the right words. Everybody needs to hear the right words. A little 16-year-old girl in Massachusetts, I found this in the latest issue of Reader's Digest. Ashley Monroe, 16. She got tired of going to school and hearing all of her schoolmates put each other down and feeling bad about themselves. So you know what this young girl did? She took 1,986 sticky notes and she stuck one on every locker in the school. And it simply said, "You're beautiful." Let me tell you something. Some of those kids really needed to hear it. People need to understand we shape destiny by the words that come out of our mouth. We need to be those kind of people that not only hear the right words and say the right words, but act on the right words, like this young lady did. Two great speakers in ancient Greece, one's name was Cicero. He would speak and people would applaud him and say, "Great speech, great speech." And there was another called Demosthenes. And when he spoke, people stood up and said, "Let's march." There's a difference in hearing something good and acting on it. The words that come out of my mouth and the words that come out of your mouth shape people's destiny. This past week, have the words coming out of your mouth been positive or negative? Have they shaped someone's destiny in the right kind of way? Who have you told by your actions and by your words that you are beautiful? Let's do an experiment. Look at the person sitting to your right or to your left or in front of you or behind you. Everybody needs to say it to someone. Look at them right now and tell them, you are beautiful. Right now, tell them. Some of you guys, some of you that are sitting beside me, you're going, I don't want to tell him he's beautiful. Let me tell you, it's not about what you look like on the outside. What we have to communicate is the truth of what God says about us, that He loves us, that He sent His Son Jesus to die for us. That makes us beautiful. That makes us people of value, people of worth. We shape destiny by what we communicate with our mouths. It is a matter of life and a matter of death. We've got to get better. It's speaking the truth in love. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. Second thing we discover, my words do matter. My words can heal or my words can hurt. We look down in Proverbs chapter 12, verse 18. There's one who speaks like the piercings of a sword, but the tongue of the wise promotes health. You know, you can put a scalpel in the hand of a surgeon, and that surgeon who is skilled and wise in utilizing that scalpel can heal your body. But you put it in the hands of a fool, it's going to hurt more and more and more. The truth is that you and I, the words that we use, they can go a long way to healing people, to helping people get better, or we can go a long way to hurting people. It's all about words and the power that's found in them. We hurt people unintentionally with our words, but unintentional hurt, it counts. We don't have to just stab people on purpose with the words that come out of our mouth. Sometimes it can be the word that goes unsaid that hurts the most. Like I love you. Like you're important to me. Like I care about you. You see, my words are important because they can heal or they can hurt. Think about it. What if you were rewarded and you got a dime with every positive, every uplifting word that you spoke? If you got a dime for that. But what if they took a nickel away from you every time you said something negative? Let me ask you a question. Would you be rich or poor? If your life is nothing but negative, if you're always talking down to people, if you're always trying to if you're hurting people by the things that you say, my guess is you're broke. But it doesn't have to be that way. What Solomon wants us to do is get smart and master our mouths. Here's the fallacy. We say we live in a country where we have, here's the words, freedom of speech. Let me tell you something. As a follower of Jesus Christ, we are part of a different kingdom. I am no longer at liberty to say anything I choose to say. We live in a world that believes if it gets between your ears, it automatically has to come out of your mouth. How many of you know what I'm talking about? Let me tell you. As a follower of Jesus Christ, some things that get between your ears needs to stay right there. Because the words that come out of your mouth can either hurt or they can heal. Think of how much hurt we could avoid if we left the words unspoken. I don't have to say and teach everything I know. Aren't you glad of that? We'd be here till 4 o'clock this afternoon if I just stayed focused on the mouth. But I'm not going to give you everything I know. Why is it that we understand that when it comes to preachers and preaching, but we don't always understand that when it comes to gossiping? Sometimes things are left, they're best left unsaid. My words matter, and your words matter. Repeat it again. My words are important. They're important because They're shapers of destiny because they can heal, they can hurt. Number three, third thing, my words can extinguish or they can intensify anger. Words can have an impact on a tense situation. Listen to what it says. Proverbs chapter 15, verse 1. A soft answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. Anybody besides me ever been in an argument, a disagreement with somebody, and you think you're going to say something that's going to win you the day, only to make the situation worse? Any of you husbands out there ever done that when you're arguing with, when you're disagreeing with your wife? Yeah, some of you are honest enough. Me and Mark, we're the only ones that have that problem. The reality is that the words that we use can extinguish that anger or they can intensify that anger. Words are power. The words that we use in relationships can change that situation. You know, it's a beautiful day outside. I'm hoping to get out and enjoy part of it. I'm sure you're hoping I get finished with the sermon so that you can enjoy part of it too. You get out and you get into the sun, and the sun is warm and it gives light and it feels pretty good today. I mean, it's really pretty nice. But if you magnify it and you focus it and you use it, you can actually intensify it to the place that it'll burn you and leave a scar. Let me tell you something about words. Our words are like the sun. Our words can illuminate the darkness. Our words can provide warmth and comfort. Or our words can burn people and scar them in ways that the naked eye cannot see. Our words are important. Our words can shape destiny. Our words can heal and hurt. Our words can extinguish or intensify. Mother Teresa said, "Words which do not give the light of Christ increase the darkness." I think she's right. Words that don't glorify God glorify Satan. Well, that's pretty harsh, isn't it? But it's true. Because our words are important. My words and your words are important. Fourth thing, number four. My words can deliver or they can destroy. Listen to what it says. The hypocrite with his mouth destroys his neighbor, but through knowledge the righteous will be delivered. The hypocrite with his mouth destroys other people. Isn't it amazing? I have seen churches survive infidelity, and I've seen it be split completely apart and torn asunder by gossip. Isn't that amazing? How the power of words can change things. How the power of words can deliver or destroy. But I only tell the truth. That's what we say. But you know what? Sometimes the truth needs to be unsaid. Sometimes we simply need to recognize the power that our words carry. We need to recognize the power that's in them. We need to get smart and become deliverers. The right word said at the right time can change someone's outlook on the day. You know, when I had you look at the person next to you and say, "You're beautiful," everybody smiled. Everybody smiled. Because that word made everybody feel good. It made us feel pretty good. You see, the truth is, everybody needs, everybody wants, everybody desires what I call warm fuzzies. That right word at the right moment. Let me be honest with you. Doing what I do, doing what Jim and Dave do, doing what Jacob does, it's a very frustrating work. And it can be very discouraging. You know, I get up here Sunday after Sunday and I preach, I sweat, I sling sweat four rows deep and spit on the first two rows. I mean, you work hard at it, you preach your heart out, and then nothing happens. And you kind of get discouraged. And then somebody comes and says, "That's a great sermon. I really got something out of it. That's what I needed to hear." And that word delivers for at least another week. It delivers. It encourages. It builds up. It doesn't destroy. In the same sense, though, someone can speak the wrong word at the wrong time. someone can make themselves feel big by making you feel small and hurt you and destroy you. My words are important and so are yours. Repeat it again. My words are important. See, if you don't get anything else out of this message today, I hope you leave here, and when you start to say something this week, I hope you think, my words are important. Maybe I need to be more careful in what I say. Fifth thing, and this is the scary one, my words can be a demonstration of or a deterrent to worship. This is serious. Listen to what Solomon says. Lying lips are an abomination to the Lord. Those who deal truthfully are His delight. Abomination, that's a big word. You hear that word thrown around a lot by churchy people. Oh, that's sin. That's an abomination before God. Let me tell you something. I just realized when I read that passage, I'm guilty. An abomination, that says lying lips. That says the words that come out of my mouth can be an abomination between me and God. It can be that one thing that separates me from Him, that corrupts my time of worship. How many times have I come and gone through the motions on Sunday morning, preaching a sermon, singing the songs, lifting your hands, clapping along with the music? How many times have we done that, but our lips have been deceitful, and our heart has not been right? We find ourselves in that place. See, I thought abominations were really big sin. You know, an abomination is that sin that I am personally offended by. Of course, I don't ever do that one, but this says lying lips are an abomination before God. Man, that brings it pretty close to home. Anybody besides me willing to admit that you're a liar? Those of you that didn't raise your hands, we're going to have to deal with that next week. You see, the reality is any sin is an abomination before God. Not just the ones that I don't like, but any sin. And so that means that my words can be a demonstration of right worship, or it can be a deterrent to worship. Maybe what we need to start doing is we need to move the invitation to the beginning of the service so that when we come together, we have the invitation, we're able to come forward and say, Lord, I'm a sinner before You. Forgive me of my sins. I want to worship in Your presence. Maybe the first thing that we should do instead of the last thing is to come before God and seek His forgiveness. An abomination is that thing which separates us from Him. The Bible talks about idol worship being an abomination. It talks about alternative lifestyles being an abomination. But it talks about me being an abomination because, you know, when your wife comes up and asks you, honey, does this dress make me look? You got to be careful. My words either get me in trouble or keep me out of trouble. You see, the truth is, lying lips are an abomination to God because my words are important. The words that you speak and the words that I speak in our daily interaction with people, we're either going to expand the kingdom and spread the light, or we're going to shrink the kingdom and let the darkness have its way. Here's the good news. Roman numeral 2 in your outline. I can master my mouth. That's the good news. My words are important, and the good news is I can master my mouth. Listen to what Solomon says. The heart of the wise teaches his mouth and adds learning to his lips. The heart of the wise teaches his mouth, instructs his mouth, teaches his mouth what he should say, when he should say it, and how he should say it. Teaches his mouth to speak those things that are in agreement with God's Word. See, that's the safest ground. That's the safest words to come out of our mouths are the words that we find God speaking. We want to speak in agreement with Him. The truth is that you and I can master what we say. We can teach our mouth so that God receives the glory. Think about the power of words. When God chose to create the universe, this is what the Bible says. And God said, there's the use of words, let there be, and there was power in those words. And when God sought to redeem fallen creation, according to John chapter 1, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. It was the Word that makes the difference. I can master my mouth. I can use the words for good and not evil. I can use the words to build up and not tear down. I can use my words to grow the kingdom, to glorify Him. Think about it. Wouldn't it be wonderful to come to this place on Sunday morning and to be able to praise God with lips that had not cursed someone in the past week? Wouldn't it be wonderful to be able to praise God with lips that had not hurt someone's feelings by what they said? Wouldn't it be wonderful to be able to worship God on Sunday because we've been worshiping Him through our demonstration of relationship with Him by what we've said all week long? My words are important. Say it again. My words, are important. Next week we're going to get real practical. Things that we can do to educate our mouth, to teach our tongue, to get to that place where we can be and master our mouths. The question becomes, how do we begin? Well, I guess the first place to begin is by accepting the Word that became flesh. You want to master your mouth, the first thing to do is to accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. John said, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And that Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory as of the only begotten of the Father. Jesus said, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. The first step in controlling our mouths is to accept Jesus Christ as our personal Savior and Lord. We must accept the Word that became flesh. Second step, we have to commit ourselves to the Word. We must commit ourselves to follow Him. That means, you know what? I need to be committed to watching what I say. I need to be committed to watching how I say it. I need to be committed to being careful with my words, recognizing that they are powerful and that they make a difference. That's what it means to be committed to follow Christ. Whether it's the written word or the spoken word, I need to be careful with my words because I'm releasing power that can either heal or hurt, that can deliver or destroy, that can build up or tear down. I must be committed to Him. And then lastly, and I thank God for this one, I got to trust Him to transform me. I got to trust Him to change me. He's got to change this little thing that's right in here that is so hard for me to control, this thing called my tongue, my mouth. He's got to change the things that I say. I think it was the book of James that said, see what a great fire such a little thing can kindle as the tongue. I've got to trust Him to change me, to transform me, to turn me into that man, to turn me into that woman, or turn you into that woman that controls and masters the tongue. Your words are important. as you go out into this community, your words are important. The things that you say will either help people step toward Christ or away from Christ. The words that I say will either bring people toward Christ or away from Christ. Our words really do matter. It's a matter of life and death. Those words shape destiny. They hurt, they heal. Our words deliver and destroy. Our words make a difference. One more time.
My words
are important.
Are important.
Let's bow together. Father.